Let's take our Bibles this morning. Let's turn to 1 Chronicles, chapter number 29. 1 Chronicles, chapter 29. Well, let's just read through the first five verses of this passage. We'll kind of be skipping around throughout the whole chapter. And this is a chapter towards the end of David's life as king. And he is preparing everything for the temple and the building of the temple. So let's just start off in 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse number 1. Furthermore, David the king said unto all the congregation, Solomon my son, whom alone God hath chosen. He's yet young and tender. And the work is great, for the palace is not for man, but for the Lord God. Now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God the gold for the things made of gold, and silver for the things made of silver, and brass for the things of brass, and iron for the things of iron, wood for the things of wood, and onyx stones, and stones to be set, glistening stones of diverse colors, and all manner of precious stones, and marble stones in abundance. Moreover, because I have set mine affection to the house of my God, I have of mine own proper good of gold and of silver, which I have gotten to the house of my God over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house, even 3,000 talents of gold and of ophir and 7,000 talents of refined silver to overlay the walls and the house withal, the gold for the things of gold, the silver for the things of silver, and for all manner of work to be made by the hands of the artificers. And here's where we're going to key in on our message this morning. Last part of verse number 5. And who then is willing to consecrate his service this day unto the Lord? I've titled the message, The Call for Consecration. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll get started. Thank you so much, Lord, for the truth of your word and what you have done for us. You have done everything for us. And you now call us to consecrate our lives to you. May we understand what this consecration is. May we realize all that is necessary and involved in it. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to be willing to make that choice. May we leave this service today, be fully and completely consecrated and dedicated to you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm interested in this thing called extreme sports. You ever hear of it? I think the media just coined the term so that they could make more money off of it. But it's the kind of sports that you put your life on the line when you do it. It's called extreme sports because it's extreme. And there are a lot of different extreme sports. I started looking at a list and someone listed over 50 different extreme sports you can participate in. Of course, now with GoPros, we don't have to actually go and participate. We can watch some other crazy guy try it out and realize we no way we're doing that, right? But there are some amazing extreme sports. One of them I came across was called zorbing. You ever heard of that? How many have heard of zorbing? Okay, one. Yeah, you get this big inflatable ball and you put yourself inside of it and you inflate the ball up and then someone pushes you down a hill. It's pretty exciting. Zorbing, there you go. We've probably heard some of these others, like cliff diving. You know, you jump off a cliff because jumping off of low things isn't exciting enough. There's some called bungee jumping. We've heard of that. That's a popular one. There's this new one where you put on a wingsuit, and it's literally a suit that has these little wings in between, and you jump out of an airplane or something and fly or try to fly, and then you pull your ripcord as you get close to the ground. We've heard of base jumping. Here was a new one to me. I had never heard of this one. It's called volcano boarding. Volcano boarding. Yeah, you climb up an active volcano, get yourself a toboggan, like a little piece of plywood, sit down on that piece of plywood and race down the... Wow, that's crazy. They can get up to speeds of 50 miles an hour going down that, and they steer with their feet. No, not for me. why in the world would they do these sorts of things? Why would they stare, as one person said, they stare death in the eyes and try not to blink? Why? Why would you do this? Why would they put their life on the line? Why would they seek this kind of adrenaline rush? One person said that they do this because they want to experience life to the max. They want to have an experience, a rush that it proves that they're alive, that shows that they're going to be living life to the max. Well, I'm here this morning to tell you that living life to the max is not in extreme sports. But living life to the max is in extreme surrender to Jesus Christ. It's in consecrating ourselves to Jesus Christ alone. If anybody proved that consecration to Jesus was worth it and that it was worth investing their life in and having a life that's consecrated to the Lord in experiencing this kind of extreme surrender, it was the life of David. David was a man's man, wasn't he? He, from the very time when he was a young boy, surrendered his life to the Lord. I don't know what that commitment looked like, but we see from the very time when he is very young, he's serving the Lord and doing what's right. And he's the kind of guy that could play a harp 1 minute and take the head off a 10-foot giant the next. You wouldn't call him a sissy, you'd call him a man's man. And with the exception of maybe two times in his life where he had extreme failures, his whole life was dedicated and consecrated to the Lord. I find it interesting that in 1 Chronicles, which is the biography of David, we don't even find his failure at all. God chose not to record it there for us. I think that's because he sought God in forgiveness, with genuine heart of forgiveness. And God forgave him. And God didn't even record it here in the book of Chronicles. But he was a man that demonstrated extreme surrender and showed that his life was fully consecrated to the Lord. And in fact, he ends his life proving that. If you look in chapter 29, verse number 28 describes the end of his life. The Bible says in verse number 28, "And he died in a good old age, full of days," and then it just uses these two words, "riches and honor." Riches and honor. So he had a quantity of life. He lived a long time, good old day. I mean, to the end. I think that's because he was obedient when he was young. That's part of it. There's much more to it than that, but God has promised us long life if we'll obey. Wow. That's the first commandment with promise. So he lived a long life, but he lived a quality of life where at the end of his life he died with respect and he died with riches. Riches and honor. And the name David is synonymous with Israel. Anyone from Israel who knows anything about Israel is going to know the name David. He died with great honor. You don't die that way without having lived a consecrated life. And so David proves that his life was consecrated to God. And he then in this whole chapter goes through the process of preparing the way for Solomon to build the temple. God had said, "David, you're not going to be the one to build the temple. You've got bloody hands. It's going to be your son, Solomon." But David realizes Solomon, he uses the phrase young and tender. That's not the way we would use it today normally. But it just means that he was inexperienced. He hasn't done this kind of thing before. He hasn't been king. He doesn't know what to expect. So we've got to prepare for him. We've got to set things right for him. We've got to get things ready and all set and in place so that he can do the work. And so David makes the challenge to all of Israel as he stands before Israel, an old man. And the challenge is, who then is willing to consecrate his service this day unto the Lord? First of all, I want you to notice that there's a worthy cause. A worthy cause. Verse number 1. Let's go back to verse number 1. Furthermore, David the king said unto all the congregation, Solomon, my son, whom alone God hath chosen, is yet young and tender, and the work. Stop right there. What does that word work mean? It means the mission, the adventure, the business, the task at hand, the work. And then he goes on to describe this work, that it's great. It's noble. It's valuable. It's important. The work is great. Let me ask you this question. Do you have a noble cause for this year? Are you living a noble life that's worth it? Are you investing your life into something that's going to pay eternal dividends? Or is consecrating everything to God worth it? David proves and says that it's worth it. There is a worthy cause. David says this palace is not for man. I love that he uses palace. It's not just a building. This is going to be a palace. This is for God. He says this is for the Lord, the self-existent one. This is for God, the supreme one. This is not for man. Listen, all the heathen have their temples. And they've built their big structures to their false god, which can't see, can't hear, can't do anything for them. But this palace, this is for the Lord God. This is for our God, and it must be done right. The cause is noble. The cause is worth it. Only that which boasts of God is worthwhile in this life. That's why verse number 11, when David praises God for all that he's doing, he says, Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and in the earth is Thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord. Thou art exalted as head above all, both riches and honor. They come from Thee, and Thou reignest over all. And Thine hand is power and might, and in Thine hand it is to make great and to give strength unto all. Do we understand who God is and what He has done? Do we understand the great salvation which He has offered us? And how Jesus Christ has come to this earth and given everything for us, laid down His life, took our sin upon Himself, became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. Do we understand God's greatness, that He is worth it? He's worth our all. 1 Chronicles 16:29, Give unto the Lord the glory, due His name. Matthew 5:16, Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Galatians 6:14, But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of Jesus Christ. I like this one, Ephesians chapter 6. There's three different times in this chapter where we hear the phrase that we should be to the praise of His glory. That should be our purpose. That should be our goal. That is our consecration unto the Lord. If you have any other major single goal in your life than giving glory to God, then you're a backslider. You're not right with God. Because God made us for His design, and His design is that we might bring glory to His name. First of all, I want you to see the temple parallel in this, that God is worthy and there is a temple parallel. David's talking about a building, a temple. But we don't have temples today. God says we are the temple of God. God does not live in a building anymore. He lives in our body. 1 Corinthians 3:16, Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? 1 Corinthians 6:19, What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? By the way, that word temple there is not just referring to the whole court and all that that temple was back then. It's actually the word used for the Holy of Holies. Wow. So the application can be made. We are the Holy of Holies, the very presence of God in us. The word temple is used 183 times in the Bible, and it just means sanctuary, a separate place, separated from the world unto God. The temple belongs to God, and it was His alone. If you're saved, you've trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you are the temple of God. And everything you are belongs to God. He made your eyes to see Him. He made your ears to hear Him. He made your mouth to praise Him. He made your heart to love Him. He made your hands to serve Him. He made your feet to walk with Him. And if you use what God has paid for and separated unto Himself for anything other than for His glory, then you're robbing God, because you're His. That's the temple parallel, but there's also a temple principle. The palace was not for man, but for the Lord God. The primary function of the temple was for worship. Worship. Now, worship is one of these buzzwords we hear a lot. It's used a lot, inappropriately, I believe, in many circles. Because most people that use this term worship, we hear the terms praise and worship, or go to the worship center. Quite often it's used in the wrong way. What does worship mean? Well, the word worship comes from a term used to describe a man who came and fell flat on his face before a sovereign. It's used in our chapter here, chapter 29, if you look at verse number 21. They sacrificed sacrifices unto the Lord and offered burnt offerings unto the Lord on the morrow after that day, even 1,000 bullocks and 1,000 rams and 1,000 lambs, and their drink offerings and sacrifices in abundance for all Israel. I missed it. That's the wrong verse. Where is it that they worship? Did I not get the right reference here? That's one of the scariest things to happen while you're up here preaching, right? Where it says that they all worshiped the Lord and the King. Oh, the verse above it. Verse number 20. There it is. And David said unto all the congregation, Now bless the Lord your God. And all the congregation blessed the Lord their God and the fathers and bowed down their heads and worshiped the Lord and the King. You see, it was used often in the Old Testament in reference to worshiping a sovereign. What does that mean? That they would bow down before a sovereign? Well, they're declaring their allegiance to the king. They're declaring that all that the king has is theirs. And that's what we should be in our worship. We should be saying that God is worth it. That's the two words there, worship, worth. Ship. We are bowing down and saying, God, you're worth it. God, you're worth everything I have. And it's often used other places where they would bow down and kiss the hand or bow down and kiss the feet of the sovereign. God, you're worth it. You're worth my everything. All that I have is yours. We need to be totally and absolutely convinced of the total worth of God, and that He is worth every ounce of our being. If you can go into a place and call it worship, but not experience, it's not an experience. We need to say that. Worship is not an experience. It's not an emotion. It's an understanding. It's a reality of the truth connecting who God is and bowing before His sovereign control. Do we worship God like we should? That is what the temple was for, and that is who we should be as the temple of God. You see, worship is not just confined to 30 minutes with a bass guitar. Worship is a 24/7 thing. It must come from our hearts and come from the truth of who God is. God demands of every born-again believer that we declare His worth in everything we do. Worship has seen the worth of God in giving Him everything He is worth. Could you prove by your life and the past 6 months that God's been worth it? Has God been worth your time? Has God been worth your prayers? Has God been worth your love? And He said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. John chapter 14. Has God been worth your obedience? We need to say in every part of our life, God, you're worth it. Why do we have the job we have? Why do we do the things we do? Is it to declare the worth of God? Are we living by the seat of our pants, going through life on our own, or are we living by the truth of the Word of God, saying, God, you're worth it. I'm going to follow what you say. There is a worthy cause, and we need to recognize that our whole existence is to say, God, you are worth it. The cause is worth it. But secondly, I want you to see that there is a willing choice. There's a willing choice. Verse number 2, David says, now I have prepared with all my might for the house of God the thing gold. I've prepared this, I've done this. But then he jumped down to the end of verse 5 and he says, who then is willing? Who's willing? You know, David could have demanded this as king. He could have demanded the offering be brought, the gold be brought, the silver be brought. He could have taxed them for it. But any work done for God should be done willingly. And because of this willing choice, verse number 9 tells us that then the people rejoiced, for they offered, what's that word, willingly. Because with a perfect heart they offered willingly. It's used twice in this verse. Willingly to the Lord. And David the king also rejoiced with great joy. They came with a willing heart. You know, salvation is a choice. God offers us that choice to trust in Him. He says, come unto me and be ye saved. He says, but as many as received Him, to them gave He power. We need to come. We need to receive. We need to believe. There's a choice involved. And if we die and go to hell, we're going to wake up in hell and not blame God, not be angry at God. We're going to be angry at ourselves for not making that choice. It's not God's fault, it's our fault. We must make that choice to receive Him and to believe on Him. Surrender is also a choice. Consecrating our hearts to the Lord is a choice. When Paul wrote in the book of Romans, the first 11 chapters, he describes everything that God has done for us. And in chapter 12, he begins to move from doctrine to duty, and he says that we've all been cursed, we're all doomed because of sin, and we have no hope. But God is rich in mercy, where with the great love He had for us, He's offered us eternal life. And then he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, therefore, because of what God has done for us, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice unto God, which is your reasonable service. The word reasonable comes from the Greek word logikos, logical. It's only logical that we give our service to God, that we consecrate our life to Him, our bodies to Him. That's only logical because of what He has done for us. And if we do not consecrate our hearts and our lives to Him, our bodies to Him, we are not logical. We are illogical. We're foolish. The word consecrate is used 9 times in the Old Testament. 6 times it's used of a ram that was sacrificed unto God. The application in the New Testament is that we're no longer bringing a lamb and sacrifice, but we're sacrificing our lives to Him. We're laying down our lives in full surrender, given over completely to God, conformed to His image through His Word. Three times that word consecrate is used in reference to a man, the priest, who is to consecrate himself unto God. Now, we're not priests. We don't wear a backwards collar. You shouldn't anyway, because that's not right. That's not biblical. But wait a minute. What's 1 Peter 2:9 say? We all are priests. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of Him who hath called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Revelation 1:5-6 says, unto Him that loved us and hath washed us from our sins in His own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God. We don't have to go through a mediator. We are the priests that have direct access to the throne room of God. Direct access to the Holy of Holies within. Wow. Who then is willing to consecrate His service? And there's that little phrase in there, this day, not tomorrow, not someday, this day. There's a spontaneous nature to this consecration. And we understand when we see the truth of who God is, our consecration must be a spontaneous reaction to that truth. I love how the book of Mark always talks about this action. We were talking in our Sunday school class of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, how each one is unique in its own way and paints the perfect portrait of Jesus Christ. And here's Mark, who always uses this phrase, straightway, immediately. And he's using all these actions and its quickness of action. Immediately, straightway, they forsook their nets and followed Him. It was an immediate consecration, a spontaneous consecration. And can we do no less when we understand what God has done for us? Why in the world would we wait or hesitate? And I give God everything. It needs to be a spontaneous consecration. It needs to be a sacrificial consecration. David gave sacrificially. I'm amazed as I study this passage as to just how much David was willing to give. And in verse number 3, this isn't just any giving. This isn't out of the king's treasury. This isn't out of some treasure chest that's sitting around. This is out of David's own pocket. Verse number 3, moreover, because I have set mine affection to the house of my God, I have mine own proper good given. And what's he give? Verse number 4, even 3,000 talents of gold and gold of Ophir. It's a special kind of gold. It's the purest kind of gold. Well, what's a talent? Well, talent was their biggest measurement of weight. How much was it? I don't know. I studied and tried to figure this out. Best guess, if we were to measure this approximately, we would say a talent is equal to about 75 pounds. If you take that weight of 75 pounds and compare it to what gold is worth in today's culture, we would have to say that each talent was about $26,474. That's per pound. Then we take it into talents to pound. Big complicated. And then they have different ounces in gold is different than ounces in everything else. Did you know that? They have troy ounces, and it's really complicated in how you switch it over. So you have to take the troy ounce and convert it to regular ounces and then convert that to pounds and then figure it all out. What is the total? All right. $5.9 billion in gold. Rough estimate. That's not including the refined silver. Let's add the refined silver. That's another $185 million. We're talking about $6 billion. This is no small amount. But you remember that verse that described the end of David's life? What did he die with? Riches. and honor. David truly was a man who knew how to be abased and how to abound in all things. He knew what it was like to live in a cave and have to beg for his food. But he knew at the end of his life what it was like to have riches. But what did he do with those riches? He gave it away. He gave it to the temple. He gave it to specific individuals and gave description of how he wanted that gold to be put into the temple, the artificers. Wow. That's consecration, sacrificial consecration. Can we apply it to our life? How was our giving? When's the last time we took a missionary out? When's the last time we used what we have in our finances for God? We're coming up on missions conference, aren't we? We're going to have a time to reevaluate that in our own budget. How much are we giving God? And who then is willing to consecrate his service unto the Lord this day? David asks that question, and the congregation responds in turn, and they give generously as well. They bring their gold, they bring their silver, and all that is necessary is brought for the temple. The provisions are all there and in place, and David rejoices. David gave a spontaneous consecration. David gave a sacrificial consecration. And David gave his service. He says in verse number 2, "Now I have prepared with all my might." All my might. This wasn't just a light-hearted thing set where he did it on the side. It wasn't a hobby. It wasn't a part, a small compartment of his life. This was all of his life. He was all in for God. This was extreme surrender. He encouraged others to do the same, and we are to do the same in our life. Encourage others to go all in for God. We're to provoke one another to love and to good works. Let's not go halfway for Jesus. God, you're worth it. There's a worthy cause. There's a willing choice. Number 3, there's a winning consequence. There's a winning consequence. They experienced something that day that was incredible. They made the choice to consecrate themselves to God in their service. And in verse number 9, the people rejoiced, for they offered willingly. It says that they went home with gladness and great joy. Verse number 21 says this again, that their sacrifices and the burnt offerings took place that day, and they did all this for God. They offered 1,000 bullocks, 1,000 rams, 1,000 lambs, and they did the drink offerings. They did all of this, their substance in abundance for Israel, and they went home tired. And they went home a little financially not as well off as their heathen neighbors. But they had joy. They had something in their lives and in their hearts that could not be described except to say Psalm 16, verse number 11, "Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand are pleasures forevermore." They experienced not just life, but life more abundantly. Life to the max. That's living. Jump down with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 5. Next book over. 2 Chronicles chapter 5. The temple work went on for about 5 months. And they finally get to the place where they have everything together and they're ready for a big consecration service of the temple. They bring the Ark of God in, and there's a great celebration. Verse number 13, "And it came to pass as the trumpeters and the singers were as one to make the sound to be heard in the praising and thanking the Lord, that when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and the cymbals and the instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever, that then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand and minister by reason of the cloud. For the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. Can you imagine all that's going on in the celebration and the music and the noise that's made from the music? And then the priest gets up to speak, and he can't speak. He can't even stand because a cloud moves in. The presence of God. God came down. He saw David and he said, David, you've done what you can. You've offered your life in sacrificial consecration to me, and you've demonstrated that in your sacrifice. You've demonstrated that in the way you've lived. And now the people have done in turn, and they've consecrated themselves. They've set themselves apart unto me. And God says, now I can move in and come down and meet with them. Be with them. If God's ever going to move in on our church and we're going to see revival here, it's only going to be because we consecrate ourselves to God, our service to God. God's only going to move when we choose to set ourselves apart for His service, move our focus from ourselves to Him alone. And when we do that, we can experience God's presence like never before. We must fully and completely consecrate to Him. If we're ever going to see salvation decisions, people walking the aisle, souls being saved, we've got to say, God, you're worth it. God, you're worth it. Is God worth your time? Is He worth your talents? Is He worth your all? It's just recently that evangelist Tom Farrell passed away. And I was thinking back to one of his sermons that he gave on this very topic. And in it, he gave an illustration of a missionary. And I tried to find where this missionary was or find some documentation to back it up, and I couldn't find it. But I feel like it's worthy to give the illustration here. She was a lady who came to her pastor. And as he tells the story, she came and said, I believe God has called me to what she called headhunters in Malaysia. And the pastor said, are you sure, young lady, you understand who these people are? They're cannibals. They eat people. Yes, I understand. I've studied them. I understand that the oil rigs have all moved out of that area and the oil companies don't want to enter that zone anymore because they've had too many people that have been murdered and eaten by these people. But I believe God has called me to tell them the truth of the gospel. And may I say that if God has called someone to tell others about Jesus, that's not Satan telling you to do that. That's God telling you to do that. You ought to be telling others about Jesus. But this pastor said, I don't know if this is right. We better take time and pray about this. She said, no, I know that this is where God's called me. And I need to go to them. So they began to pray. And at the time, there was no one who would even fly them in or take them to that location. And she couldn't even get into that location. And so much time passed, as he tells the story. And he said, finally, they found someone to bring her to that location and to drop her off. And it was a helicopter pilot. And he said, I'll take you there, but I'm not touching down. I'll lower a rope, and you've got to drop from the end of the rope. It's too dangerous for me, and I don't have enough fuel, and can't get back there for another 60 days. But I'll come back to that location. If you're there at the end of 60 days, I'll know you survived. If not, we're not coming back. She said, I'll go. I know God wants me to go. And even as she's lowering herself down on the rope, the helicopter pilot is saying, stop, no, come back. I see them coming. I see them coming. But she doesn't turn back, she drops. The helicopter pilot takes off and returns in 60 days. And here she comes. But it's not just her. There's 40 followers, 40 believers that have trusted in Christ right behind her. What happened? How did that happen? She explained the story and said that as she approached the woods and they began to come out from the woods, they bowed down to her. Why? Because they had heard a story from their youth. They're not sure where it came from, but this story was told in their tribe that a female goddess would descend from the heavens and tell them their way of salvation. God had prepared. And she saw souls saved because she had extreme surrender. If we're ever going to see God work, we must have extreme surrender. We must consecrate our service to the Lord God. Let me ask the question as David did. Who then is willing to consecrate themselves, consecrate his service this day unto the Lord? There's a worthy cause, there's a willing choice, and there's a winning consequence. Thank you so much, Lord, for the truth of your word. May we be willing to surrender.